St. Patrick's Day, everyone, and welcome to the second episode of Tea Time Tuesday. I'm your host, Griffin Kelton. This episode, we're going to be going over Irish breakfast tea. Alongside that, we'll also be talking about the advantages and disadvantages of using tea bags to brew your tea, how to use water from a hot pot to properly brew your tea without that nasty film on top, and we'll also talk about a little bit of tea vocab so that you can better describe your tea in the future. So let's go ahead and get started. I'm using Twinings again today, and this is the Irish breakfast tea container. Irish breakfast tea is a nice blend of primarily Assam and Sri Lankan Ceylon tea. It's similar to the English breakfast tea in those two regards. However, it lacks the Kenyan blend, which is going to give the Irish breakfast a robust but less harsh flavor, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit. Twinings, for the most part, likes to put their teas in bags. Great advantage of tea bags is that it's so easy. You can just put it in the hot water. Once it's brewed, you take it out, you throw it away, or you can even use it again. When you use tea bags twice, the caffeine is greatly reduced. Almost it becomes decaf tea, which for a blend like Irish breakfast can be hard to find. So here is our tea bag. Tea bags have a nice little tab on top, in case you really just don't know, that allows it to sit outside the water so you can pull it out when it's done and not burn your fingers. This paper right here is very much like coffee filter paper. It is very tightly woven, but it allows water to permeate and the tea leaves or the tea to stay in. That allows you to have a nice clean brew of tea afterwards. The tea inside here is very fine, so one of the disadvantages of using a tea bag is that afterwards, after you pour the hot water in, if you leave it in there for too long, the tea is going to become very bitter very quickly. It brews very fast, which is why on boxes of teas it says 2 to 5 minutes. Anywhere from 2 to 3 minutes is actually the optimum time for very fine tea. So let's go ahead and look at what's inside the tea bag. This tea right here is... you can tell it's very, very fine. And it's called what is a choppy tea. A choppy tea is a tea that is chopped and diced instead of being rolled or full leaves. So this is a choppy tea. It is also even, and that all the pieces are roughly the same size. You can tell that this is a double blend tea because you can see mostly it's Assam. It's about the same color, but then there's a little bit variation in there, and that is the Ceylon tea. So this is what it looks like. You can go ahead and tell up front by smelling it that your tea is going to be a little bit on the bitter side. It's not harsh. It's more what I would describe as pungent. It's pungent in the way that it's astringent. It has a little bit of bitter flavor, but it's not harsh. So it's very good. It also has a little bit of fruity flavor. Tea, when it's when the chlorophyll is oxidized out of it, and the when it's rolled and in the drying process, it begins to smell like apples. And so this fruit flavor that I'm getting, it's a little bit of pear. It's mostly leftover. So comparing it to the English breakfast tea, it's not as harsh. Like I said, it's astringent, and you have this fruitiness, which gives you a more well-rounded flavored tea. You start out with bitter, and then you end up with a nice sweet fruitiness. The English breakfast, the Kenyan, actually cancels out that fruitiness that you would normally encounter. So let's go ahead and try this tea out. Like I said, using tea bags gives you a nice clean brew, so there's nothing in there. It is, like I said, pungent. It is bitter when you get it in your mouth, not harsh, and it's not overwhelming. But in this tea, you also get that nice fruity aftertaste that is very slight, almost like a peach. It's like half peach, half pear. It's good. One of the things I would like to mention about this tea is if you are going to sweeten it with sugar, I'd advise against it, but if you have to, use just a tiny, tiny bit. because if you put too much sugar in this, you are going to ruin the flavor of the tea. You're not going to get the great bitter opening, and the opus is not going to complete with that nice fruity finale. So please, if you have to use sugar, just a little bit. Also, with the cream, use a drop. Normally, this tea is actually not had with either. If you do use cream, it's going to get rid of the boldness of this tea. And it's a really good tea. You do not want to ruin it. One of the things I would like to talk about next is when you do use a hot pot heat up water and you put it in your tea, use either distilled water or permanently hard water. If you use temporarily hard water, the calcium carbonate that's in it is going to, after a couple of minutes, rise to the surface and give you a thin film that is not only unattractive, but, I mean, it just doesn't taste as good. Also, when you use a creamer in this, the fat is also going to rise to the surface, and you're going to have a fatty, thin film on top, which also is equally unappealing, and frankly, no one can enjoy that. So, use distilled water. It's honestly the best way to go, and that way you're not going to run into nasty films. One more thing I'd like to talk about before I let you all go are an amazing health attribute that all teas have. They're called theaflavins. The technical term is polyphenol flavin threols, also known as flavanols with an A, not an O. They're called cations. But all that chemistry terminology aside, theaflavins are, when they were originally discovered, were called vitamin P. They are an amazing antioxidant that does wonders to the body, such as apoptotizing to colon cancer cells, causing them to destroy, binding to the GP41 protein of HIV phase 2, or HIV, which prevents the onset of phase 2, binding to the 3CL proprotein and SARS, preventing that onset, and they also prevent cholesterol from binding to your artery walls, keeping your artery walls nice and soft. Theaflavins also work alongside EGCG. It was advertised in Lipton commercials a little bit back. The technical term is ebogallocation gallate. So that's EGCG. The theaflavins work alongside that to bind to GP120, which also prevents the onset of HIV phase 2. And HIV phase 2, that's when it starts to get bad. So, with all those things in mind, how can you say no to tea, right? Thanks for tuning in, everyone. Before I let you go, we have a contest coming up. And what you have to do is join our Facebook group. Just type in Tea Time Tuesday in the search bar. Become our fan. And I'll send out instructions to all our fans later this week. But to win our contest, you will receive a temperature-adjustable 32-ounce hot pot. You will also win a box of Irish breakfast tea and a box of English breakfast tea. So find us on Facebook. We're also on Twitter, twitter.com/teatimetuesday. I am twitter.com/griffinkelton. We're on YouTube, youtube.com/teatimetuesday. That's where you're probably watching us right now. And our website should be up soon. TeaTimeTuesday.com. We're having a little trouble with the registrar right now, but that should all be taken care of shortly. So once again, I'm your host, Griffin Kelton. Thanks for tuning in, and don't forget to watch us next week. We're going to be covering Kenyan Sunrise Black Tea. See you then. Have a great night.